she's confused.
So this is a talk today by Spoken Life, and I'm presenter for tonight's done by Illuminating Talks for both the Ottawa and Carleton University. And our presenter tonight is Pastor Luke Thompson. He has both an MA in philosophy and an MA in theology, and since then, he has taught philosophy at universities in the United States, and he has lectured internationally as well as a guest speaker on pop culture and philosophy. And so we've done a couple talks here at Carleton as well. We've one in contemporary horror and one on zombies as well. So I'm going to head over. Thank you.
I did know Ruth. She wasn't just my ally, she was my friend. I see her in the flowers that grow in the meadow by my house. I hear her in a Mockingjay song. I see her in my sister, Pip. She was too young, too gentle. And I couldn't save her. I'm sorry.
So if I was to ask you what the number one box office or kind of gross, money-making films are of books that have been adapted to movies, at least young adult books, what books would come to mind? Besides The Hunger Games, what else would you think of?
Lord of the Rings.
Harry Potter, right? So especially Harry Potter we might think of, right? And so just maybe to help kind of put this into context here, this is lifetime gross, right? So this is total amount that a film has made so far. Harry Potter is number 3 and 4, Deathly Hallows, right? Or it's not even 4, it's number 3. Hunger Games is 1, 2, and 4. That's amazing to think about, right? That the Hunger Games franchise is making more money than some of the Harry Potter movies are, right? And if you go just a little bit further, so Twilight, no one said Twilight. I don't know why. But right, we got it starting down there at number 7, but it's up there as far as adaptations, right? Some of the other Twilight movies, but if you get down to right around 1918, that's when you start having the Divergent series start coming in, and I think there's one of the, Maze Runner is down there as well at number 23. And so this is quite a bit less, right? That's 102 million as opposed to the Mockingjay film? Yeah, 400, right? So as soon as you kind of get down to the 20s, it's a whole lot less. But that is crazy to think about. That in these top movies, in the top 25, you have tons of what we call dystopic films. So the question is, why in the world now, at this time in history, are we so obsessed with dystopias, especially about it, the amount that this has taken over young adult literature. Now that's an interesting question in of itself, right? If we think for a minute, especially where these films are getting made, North America, kids have never had it better in the history of the world. And yet, the films and the books that they're reading are dystopic. So, what's a dystopia? Define for me dystopia.
Opposite of a utopia.
Opposite of a utopia! Yeah, good. Well, what's a utopia? A utopia is a?
Perfect society.
Yeah, perfect society. Who came out with like this idea of the utopia, invented that language? Yeah, Thomas More, right? So he came up with the idea. A dystopia, obviously it's going to be the opposite of a utopia, but we're saying it in a very specific sense, right? Because there's obviously lots of things that are opposites of a utopia. So in what sense is a dystopia the opposite of a utopia? Anyone know? Anyone talk about this in their lit classes? Yeah?
A society that doesn't work.
What's that?
A society that doesn't work.
Yeah, right, so it's a society that's not working, and how did it get there? This is the key. They were trying to make a utopia, right? So the goal was that somehow government thought that they could manufacture a utopia, and instead they produced a monster of some sort, something that's completely the opposite of what ideally they were trying to strive for. And so that's what we've got going on here. And so what we're going to do, just in the next 45 minutes to an hour here, is we're going to see how in the world we got from our traditional understanding of a utopia. So 1984 is going to be our kind of quintessential traditional utopia. How did we get from there to teen dystopias? How are we going to get there to teen dystopias like the Hunger Games, which is going to be quintessential? And so we're going to do this by first looking at development of dystopias, the themes that run through them, and then young adult dystopias, their development and their themes. And so we're gonna start all the way back at the very beginning of things. And the first novel that is associated with dystopias is by this guy here, Jack London. How do you know Jack London? Yeah, lots of major stuff, right? Like Call of the Wild and his other big one. That you know him by? White Fang, right? So Call of the Wild and White Fang are his two most famous ones, but he wrote a book called The Iron Heel. Jack London was a socialist, and so he created this book because he was trying to show that he believed capitalism, according to a Marxist model, that it's going to lead to a terrible society in the future. So this is the first one that's really kind of marked as a real kind of dystopia. Eventually a totalitarian government is going to be established because of capitalism gone wrong. The next one then, right on the heels of it, the fact it was published in serial film before Iron Heel, was H.G. Wells' The Sleeper Awakes, or When the Sleeper Awakes. And so the premise of this is that a very rich guy falls asleep. He gets put into basically, coma, but like when you do it on purpose, what am I thinking of?
Stasis.
Yeah, right? And so he's put in this for a while, and then when he wakes up, turns out that his investments and everything like that has made him not only the richest man in the world, but he owns everything. And so he wakes up to what's called a plutocracy. What's a plutocracy? This is very important for dystopian themes. A plutocracy? Ruling by the
Plutarch.
I don't know if it's maybe etymologically tied to that, but the rich, right? So plutocracy is the rich people owning everything, which is a major theme of young adult type stuff that we're going to see as well. But yeah, so he's also a socialist, and he's creating a world as well where capitalism has kind of gone crazy. But in it, he's got a lot of interesting themes, especially dealing with the idea of the masses being influenced by technology and by pleasure and stuff like that. And so there's going to be a lot of echoes, if you read this, a lot of echoes that you're going to find, especially in Brave New World. So there's going to be things that kind of get established there. But by far and away, the place that we can called the first real modern dystopian novel. It's going to be by this guy, Yevgeny Zamyatin. Has anyone ever read We? If you like 1984, this is really kind of the book that establishes the genre. You read this, and it feels like you are reading a 1984-ish or Brave New World-ish type dystopia. And here we got, he's a Russian guy. He's portraying another future totalitarian state. The city where everyone lives is a giant glass city. Why would you want to live in a giant glass city? So that the secret police can have easier surveillance over everyone. It's a scientifically run future. Here he's warning about science gone awry. And so there's no names anymore. The main hero is D-503, who is part of a resistance. And at the end of it, you're not too sure whether or not the resistance ends. But you see a lot of, again, themes that kind of get established or get put into the minds of authors for the next few generations. But by far and away, the thing that establishes the dystopic genre in the minds of the masses is Metropolis. And so we were playing clips of that beforehand. And what's interesting is that when it came out, H.G. Wells said that Metropolis was a film of foolishness, cliché, platitude, and muddlement about mechanical progress and progress in general. So it had mixed reviews when it came out. But now, almost 100 years later, it's got a 99% rating on Rotten Tomatoes based on 115 reviews. And you could make a list of quotes from film critics like Roger Ebert that says this is one of the greatest achievements in film. But as maybe, I don't know if you had a chance to kind of glance at the stuff that was going on beforehand, what kind of themes are explored in Metropolis? Any idea? What were the things that you saw? The what?
Like the mechanical.
Yeah, right. So the guy with the giant clock, right? And so you have this thing where people are being treated like machines, right? In the very beginning of the film, there's everyone's marching out of work in time and in step and things like that. Yeah, what else did you see?
Really big walls.
Yeah, right. Huge kind of monolithic walls all over the place. Yep. Yeah, the robot, right? The robot in Metropolis is super famous. But yeah, this idea of science and robots and things like that being evil, there's a big kind of theme running through that. We were talking about the mad scientist. Christine was saying, when we were watching this together earlier, she was saying that mad scientist looks like they're just overdoing it, right? Like the drama and stuff like that. But the reality is that was the first mad scientist on film, right? So he's establishing the genre of mad scientists as they appear in film in Metropolis. Yeah, so you have a lot of those different themes kind of running through it. If you watch it, it's a weird movie, but the one that we were playing clips from, the New Pollutants wrote a soundtrack for it, like a new soundtrack, I think, in 2010, when they kind of finally put together the real vision of Fritz Lang's, because when it came out, they took away, the government wouldn't allow a lot of it to be shown. And so finally by 1910, they've got about 95% of the film put together. And they think they know how Fritz Lang would have done it. But you can watch on YouTube, it's all free with a cool soundtrack. But it's a weird film. But by far and away, the biggest one that is probably the most famous traditional dystopia, we're gonna call it, is 1984. By George Orwell. And I read it, I did a senior thesis on it when I was graduating from university. And I read it maybe once before then, but then I reread it just a couple weeks ago. And it is just amazing when you read through this, the amount of dystopic language that he either invented or popularized that is still being used today, right? Things like Big Brother is watching. He came up with that, right? But not just that, the idea of thought crime, right? Thought police and doublethink and untruth and the ministry of truth and newspeak. And so he is establishing the language of dystopia for us. There's no question that there's other important novels, but this one really kind of establishes the genre more than any of the other ones. What's the book about, 1984? What's 1984 about? Who's read 1984? Oh, then most room knows what it's about. What's it about, 1984? Winston? Well, what's it really about?
Winston is where it's described as a really sad life.
Yeah.
And he's trying to figure out, it could be better or something like that, or if it makes sense or whatever, but he ends up going to prison, I think it is, or, going to jail. He falls in love with a girl named Julia and ends up going to, somewhere. And then at the end, you don't know if you got what ends up happening, but,
it ends bad.
Yeah. It was, I'm so kind of confused.
He's waiting for the slow bullet, right?
But
you touched on a lot of it. Yeah. Right. And so what's interesting with this book, George Orwell's, is that it's the exact opposite of things like Jack London's Iron Heel and H.G. Wells' original ones. They were socialists that were promoting a socialist mindset, and they were critiquing capitalism. George Orwell was coming from the exact opposite approach. So he was originally a socialist, but then after Stalinism, when he became disillusioned with that, along with many other people at that time, then he wrote this to warn of the problems of totalitarianism and what this could lead to, right? So, and so that's kind of what's getting developed here, right? The idea of the problems of allowing groups like Stalinistic communism to kind of take hold. But again, one of the major themes, and you just kind of look at the type of stuff that he's addressing here, thought crime, thought police, doublethink. Language plays a major role. That if you can control language, then you can control how people think. C.S. Lewis famously said, if you forget to say something, or if you've forgotten how to say something, then you'll soon forget how to think it. And that's, in a nutshell, what's going on with 1984, is the control of language. Yeah. And so around this time, then, we've got a slew of stuff that really gets developed. So Brave New World by Aldous Huxley, that's probably, along with 1984, those are the two major ones. Eugenics, right, is a major theme. Science is a major theme. Psychological conditioning and drugs. He explores that kind of side of scientism and politics, Brave New World. Ray Bradbury's Fahrenheit 451. I just saw a trailer for it the other day. HBO is going to come out with a series. What's that about? Fahrenheit 451? Burning books, right? Burning books. So censorship, right? And this is coming out during the McCarthy era, the 1950s there. And so it has a lot to do with the idea of the real threat of book burning that was possibly going to be happening in the U.S. at that time. Clockwork Orange, what's that about? This is dystopian as well. Sometimes you forget that it is, but it takes place in the future. And so here, the whole idea with Anthony Burgess's and as well as the famous film that came out, the idea is clearly this idea of rehabilitating people in culture, in a culture that's overly sexualized already, and then somehow trying to accommodate for the damage that culture's already been done. The way that they do it is by psychological conditioning. And then the question then is raised, if you use behavioralism in order to get someone to act the right way, are they actually making a choice? And have you taken away their humanity? Right. So that's kind of the themes of the Clockwork Orange. The Handmaid's Tale, what's that all about? What's that warning us about? Now this is the only Canadian one up there. I studied this in the States. So you need to educate me. What's this all about?
Reproduction that only some people or some people were, some they had surrogate reproduction for whatever reason.
Yeah, right. So the rights of sex and sexual reproduction, major theme, right, that gets played out of. What else might you say about it?
Environmentalism.
And it's extremely, it's not what we'd call anti-biblical, it doesn't seem to be the case, as far as what Margaret Atwood's name Themis, but instead it's definitely anti-conservatism or anti-religious right, that kind of warning about that kind of stuff. The Bibles are under lock and key. No one's allowed to read the Bible there except for very small rituals that take place. Whatever government's established there, they're killing other religious and Christian sects as well. So there's some type of warning about especially hardline conservatism, right? That's one of the major things that you got running through it. So just kind of taking a look at all these, though, we're going to look at one film, a dystopian film, and we're going to use it as kind of our archetype to look at how utopian films address issues. And so this next one, this is a clip from the film Brazil. Have you ever seen Brazil? Terry Gilliam's Brazil. It is very interesting. Very interesting. And the setting, for the clip that you're about to watch here, the main character, his job is he is part of a branch of the government that is looking for a terrorist, and the terrorist's name is Tuttle. Okay? So that's his job. But he wakes up in the middle of the night and his air conditioner is broken. Okay, so that's the two things you need to know. He's looking for a terrorist, and he's woken up in the middle of the night with his air conditioner broken. Okay?
Central Services, I'm at 579B, Block 19, Northwestern Section D. That's exit 1 of Green Pastures High, where the Orange Blossom flyover. I'm out for trouble with my air conditioning. It's an emergency.
Thank you for calling Central Services. I'm sorry due to temporary staff shortage. Central Services cannot take service calls centrally between 2300 and 9900. Have a nice day. This has not been a recording.
This is an emergency.
Well, thank you for calling Central Services. I'm sorry due to...
No, I've got to have a heating engineer. Hands where I can see them. What are you doing?
Tuttle, heating engineer at your service.
Tuttle? Are you from Central Services? I called Central Services.
Well, they're a little overworked these days. Luckily, I intercepted your call.
Sent for me before now. There are plenty.
with Central Services would love to get their hands on Gary Tubman. Are you telling me that this is illegal? Well, yes and no. Officially, only Central Service officers are supposed to touch the stuff. Would you hold this, please? But nowadays, with all the new rules and regulations, they can't get decent staff anymore. So they tend to turn a blind eye. As long as I'm careful, I find you whenever they can prove that I'm working on their equipment. That's quite a different color. But wouldn't it be simpler just to, you know, work for me, please? Sorry, yes. I was saying, wouldn't it be simpler to work for Central Services?
Ah! Couldn't stand the pay.
Couldn't walk.
You couldn't walk. Couldn't stand the work.
Paperwork. Couldn't stand the paperwork. Listen. This whole system of yours could be on fire, and I couldn't even turn on a kitchen tap without filling out a 27B/6 bloody paperwork.
I suppose one has to expect a certain amount.
Why? I came into this game for the action, the excitement. Go anywhere, travel late, get in, get out, wherever there's trouble, man alone. Now they got the whole country sectioned off. You can't make a move without a form.
Are you expecting more?
No.
Your eggs.
Your eggs, sir. Trouble with your air conditioning, sir.
No, it's all right. It's fixed.
Fixed?
Yes, I mean it fixed itself.
Oh, it fixed itself?
Fixed itself.
Yes.
He's not fixed himself.
Well, they don't fix themselves, sir.
Sorry you've had a wasted journey.
I think a little look with you.
No, you've got to switch up here. Have you got a 27B/6?
Now that were you done for it?
Well, have you got a 27B/6?
The sash.
It's all right. Sorry, I'm a bit of a stickler for paperwork, you see. Where would we be if we didn't stick to the correct proceedings?
We'll be back. We'll be back.
Thanks for coming. We'll be back.
Jack London, H.G. Wells, they're writing about the dangers of capitalism. What's Terry Gilliam warning us about? Did you catch what's going on? So Harry Tuttle, he's considered a terrorist. Why is he considered a terrorist?
All in the world?
Yeah, because he's an air conditioner repairman that is not filling out the proper paperwork. Right? So in this possible future, to just want to not be part of the bureaucracy of the system makes you a terrorist and into a superhero, basically, right? So what's the warning of? What's the warning? Yeah, right? Bureaucracy run amok, right? The idea of a future where we like paperwork, things like that. So that's the idea that's being set here, right? And so we see that the goal of the film, and the entire film, if you're watching it, is to kind of warn of this possible future of where we get too far into bureaucracy, especially bureaucracy caused by businesses. Businesses creating paperwork and creating all these kind of levels of separation between the consumer and the employer and the business owners and things like that. So this is a traditional dystopia, and we can learn a few things. Is not necessarily to dwell on philosophical ideas or to tell love stories or to do this or that. It's to make a comment about politics, but politics broadly speaking, right? Not just about government politics, but about politics proper, where society is going to go, right? It's about the system or the man, right? The idea of the system running amok. Right, again, our idea was that you start with a utopia, and a utopia is basically you're trying to create the perfect system in the future. And here we see warnings that if we try to take steps with these certain systems, then there's going to be huge problems in the future, right? Warnings of a possible future. Act before it's too late. So with just about all dystopias, traditional ones, they're tragedies. Now, we can find exceptions, just like you can to any rule in literature, but the vast majority of them, the most famous ones, they're tragedies. They're bad endings. If you get this far, then there's no turning back. Society's basically screwed. So you have to act now. This is a warning about what you should do now, because the possible future is going to be terrible if you allow things to continue in this trajectory or that trajectory, if you allow this person to do this thing in politics or whatever. You gotta handle it now, because in the future, it's gonna be too late. You're not gonna be able to recover from it. So that's the marks of the traditional dystopia. We got a lot of stuff that if you were to Google dystopia, these things would kind of pop up as well, right? So Blade Runner 2049, the traditional Blade Runner, Altered Carbon that just came out, that's listed as a dystopia, Ghost in the Shell. Is listed as a dystopia as well, like you're just kind of looking at, you know, the headings in Netflix or whatever it is. But here's the question we wanted to ask. Are they dystopian, or are they just in a dystopian setting? What's the difference? Are they truly dystopian? What's the marks of a dystopia again? Yeah, it's political, right? So maybe think of something like Blade Runner. What's Blade Runner about? Either the old one or the new one?
What it is to be human?
Yeah, what it is to be human. So they're technically not dystopias. They're in a dystopic setting in that it's a future that's horrible, if you want to call that a dystopic setting. But the actual works, they're exploring philosophical ideas. What does it mean to be a human? At what point, when a robot gets consciousness, is it a person? Right, things like that. But they're not political. They're not about future governments or things like that, or about the future trajectory of how we're going to set up society and how it's going to be dystopic for you right now if you were in the future. It's just exploring these things. Same with things like Ghost in the Shell. That, again, it's exploring the idea of what it's going to mean to be a human. Altered Carbon explores very similar things as well, the idea of transferring consciousness from bodies to bodies and stuff like that. So, all this to point out is that there's a lot of things that get thrown out there as dystopian, but they're really not. Just because it's a future that stinks does not mean that we're talking about a dystopia. Dystopia means that this is a political commentary that's being made, and it's tragedy. If you go down this road, there's no turning back. Okay? So those are traditional dystopias. Now, we got to talk a little bit about Katniss Everdeen and Triss and all those good people. But to start off with, we're going to start with The Giver. So the first popular, the first young adult dystopian novel that kind of sets the stage, we could probably say, is The Giver. It's a fantastic book, absolutely fantastic. Lois Lowry, she wrote lots of Newbery winners, like Number of the Stars, a few others, and this is a fantastic book as well. What's the theme of it? Anyone here read it? What's the theme of The Giver? It's a future in which everything is the same. Sameness is the idea. And so in the future, no one's going to have choices, but to remove those choices, dangerous choices, you're going to have to make everything the same. So that's the setting, and we're going to watch now what happens. So the giver is the person that is allowed to have memories. In order for everything to be the same, no one has memories of the past in any way, shape, or form. And then that way, everyone's exactly the same. They don't know they're different because they don't have any experiences of what things were like in the past and how things were different before. Everything's the same. The only people that have memories of the past, there's a guy called the giver. He's got the memories, but he's getting old, and so they're going to need a new keeper of the memories, and the giver is going to give the memories of the community, the collective memories of the past, to the new recipient of memories, all right? So, that's what's going on here. Hey, play.
We are here for only one purpose. Simply stated, although it isn't really simple at all, I will transmit to you all the memories that I hold within me. Memories of the past.
I would be very interested to learn about your life.
No, not my life. You will learn the secret history of the world. Before me, before you, generations back and back and back. When things were different, when there was more.
More?
The sheriff. You see, no one in our community has any memory of the past, only me. When the elders need guidance on matters that are beyond their experience, I provide wisdom. That is now your role, to provide guidance in the present using memories of the past. Move closer. Where to begin? Move closer. For me to prepare you for what I'm going to do now, you can take comfort in knowing you are completely helpless. If any of this proves too much for you, tell me immediately.
I just have a doctor.
Thank you. how it happened.
But it's impossible.
Yet it happened.
Well, why? Why do we have the... that thing?
Go on. The memories they give you, the word is not a thing. It's...
sled.
Sled.
And the...
snow.
Snow. Did my parents have them? Did you?
No, no. It's a very distant memory. Simply stated, there is no snow because of climate control.
But why don't people know about it? I mean, what's so dangerous about the memory of the sled?
What's so dangerous? For a sled, you need snow. Snow is cold. Cold destroys crops, which meant farmers couldn't farm. Unpredictable weather, hills, mountains, make it difficult to transport food. And we had hunger, starvation, famine. Everything is connected, everything is a balance. What's good, there is always bad.
Show me more.
Let's go for a walk. A real one with your legs.
All right, so I'm going to show you two more short clips from the movie. The book, phenomenal. The movie, I'm going to show you the two best parts of the entire movie, all right? And so as you watch the next two clips, again, they're rather short, ask yourself, what's the point of this movie? What's the director trying to communicate with us, right? So if these other dystopias were about bureaucracy or about this or about that, what is the point of The Giver, all right? So, he's just going to get more memories.
We'd been told the chief elder knew everything, things nobody else did. But I had learned that knowing what something is not the same as knowing how something feels.
You could be the very best, the last one at the top of the mountain, gasping for air, having survived, and be alone. Be curious.
I got lost, the good kind of lost. I saw sights and sounds I had no words to describe. Faces with flesh of all different colors. I felt so alive. This was forbidden. I didn't know what to think, what to believe. Have faith, the giver told me. He said faith, that was seeing beyond. He compared it to the wind, something felt but not seen.
Don't accept what is the truth just because it's coming from someone you respect.
I feel completely stupid, that weird feeling that weird tingles in your hands.
Memories are not just about the past. They determine our future. You can change things. You can make things better.
It was life. It just seemed more complete. The more I experienced, the more I wanted.
All right, so John is the main character. Eventually he's gonna have to escape, obviously, right? So the next scene, it's the setup for that.
I'm leaving tonight, and I'm going to take him with me.
John is not yet, you're not ready.
When they decided to kill Gabe, they decided I was ready.
I like this map. Don't mess it up. I'll be wanting it back. You don't mind if I accelerate your training a bit, do you? You think for someone who is the keeper of emotions that I'd be better? Well, I love you.
guy looking at all these things. Do you think he gets out? He does. He escapes. He escapes. He escapes the sameness world. What's the point of the movie?
Difference is good.
Difference is good? Yeah. Yeah.
The mold.
What's that, Emily?
Break the mold.
Break the mold? Whereas the other dystopian films and books, they're all about warnings about this dark future. This movie is all about celebrating life, right? It's the exact opposite in the sense that it is celebrating the human experience and it is celebrating the diversity that we find in our world. It is a celebration of human life and the beauty that things are not the same. And what's kind of cool is, so the book's brilliant, but the one thing that's neat about the movie is that in the book, you don't know the memories that are being transferred forward. But when you watch the film, you actually get to take a seat connected to the giver, right? You actually get to see the memories. And the memories that you see, it's all these great moments from history, right? Beautiful things. And then you realize that this is what makes life beautiful, right? The strength, so to speak, that comes through the human experience. And you get to take all of that home with you after watching the film, right, or reading the book. So it's a celebration. As opposed to the other ones that end in tragedy, this is not in a tragedy. Instead, we see hope. It's a movie of hope that change is possible, right? You heard him say it, right? You can change things. You can make things better. And so we're going to see some huge thematic differences between the way that contemporary young adult dystopias are different than traditional dystopias. These are the four big ones. There are tons out there. I bet you if you went to your bookstore right now, you could find maybe 20 different dystopian series in the young adult section. These are the four big ones. The Hunger Games is definitely the biggest one. Divergent, Maze Runner, and then the Uglies series as well, Scott Westerfeld. So Hunger Games has been made, all different trilogies, everything comes out in trilogies today, because you can make lots of money, right, in trilogies. And the Hunger Games has already been made into four movies, Divergent, three movies, Maze Runner, the third one just came out, and the Uglies series, that's the next one that's coming out. So expect in the next 5 years to see three or four movies get spun out of that. But looking at all these things, we're just going to look real briefly at the purpose of the young adult dystopias. And so we talked about this idea of sameness being explored in The Giver, and how differences are a good thing, and how it's something that celebrates life and the ability to change by knowing who you are and where you've come from. As our kind of prototypical young adult one, we're going to look at one more clip here. And this one's going to be from Divergent. What's the Divergent series about? What's Divergent about, Toby?
It's about having just one trait. So
I don't remember anymore. What did you know?
Divergent has all the traits.
Yeah, right? So there's a society where you're divided into traits. Can anyone rattle off the traits? I can't. Oh, no, really?
There's a dauntless, amity, erudite, and
right. And so everyone's separated into these five societies. So the main theme of the first movie or book, especially, is exploring this idea of whether or not you can typecast it into a certain type, right, and resisting that. But the series, they begin to explore slightly different variations of this theme as you go forward. This is in the second movie that we're going to watch here. And you just tell me, this should be, everyone should know what this is about. But real quick, that's hot.
What is going on here?
Yes. Hey!
I'm not gonna fight you.
Here we go.
How very amity of you.
I mean it. I'm not gonna fight you. Of course you're not. You're gonna fight her. The one you really hate.
So, that's Divergent. What's that about? It is so obvious, I hope. What's it about? It is not, subtlety is not the strength of the scriptwriter. Self-acceptance.
Don't fight who you are.
What's that?
Yeah,
right. Acceptance, like forgiving, right? This idea of forgiving yourself, right? Of finding some type of way of living with yourself, right? Yeah. Is this political? No. Is the Divergent series really political in any way, shape, or form? No. What about Hunger Games? Is that political? In what sense is it political? Because this is the question we need to ask ourselves then. Divergent, is it dystopian or just a dystopian setting? So it's definitely not political. The whole point of it is not to raise us all up to shake our fist at the man. Is it a tragedy? Have you watched all three, gotten all the way to the end? She wins. It's not like what you're going to call, like now they're in a utopia at the end. But they overthrow and they overcome the odds and stuff like that. Right? So it's not a tragedy by any stretch of the imagination.
But at the same time, doesn't it have some of the traits? Because if you've seen the third one, like I don't want to ruin any endings.
You can go ahead and do that.
They're a colony. They're basically a science project.
Yep.
To try to become a utopia of a broken system.
Right.
So I mean, maybe it starts out as a dystopia, but it doesn't end up as one.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, so it's not going to be, it's somewhere in the middle where it's got themes, we're going to call it a dystopia, it still fits within that. It's not a completely different genre as something like a Blade Runner would be, but there's no question it ends somewhere different.
Mockingjay as well, Maze Runner as well, these types of things. It has different purposes than a classic dystopia has. So this was one of the wallpapers, one of the theme things for Divergent when it's going around, right? There is a war inside us all. So again, the goal of this is not to warn us of a future impending doom if we go down this political road or if we follow this or that, but instead, it's right away trying to drive you to an introspective way of looking at this film. Some of the I think these are all quotes from the first novel. I don't want to be just one thing. If you don't fit into a category, they can't control you. You're different. You don't fit into a category. They can't control you. So call it Divergent, right? And so again, the whole point of it is fighting against this idea of being categorized as one thing. Cliques, right? Stuff like that. Stereotyping. That's the real point, especially in the first novel. Again, like they kind of slowly explore other things. But it is not political. It's not political in any way, shape, or form. If we're going to find some themes that run throughout all young adult dystopia, conformity versus individualism. So you think of a sameness by limiting our ability to choose a la The Giver. So we find this in not just The Giver, but this theme runs through many other young adult dystopias. Being categorized by society and the educational system. That's obviously part of what's driving the Divergent series. The Hunger Games, one of the most important lines in the books, I wish there was a way of showing they don't own me. Right? The whole goal of PETA in the first Hunger Games and then Katniss's goal in the second two books is to fight to show that the capital doesn't control you. Right? But again, is this political? It's not warning of a future political realm where this is going to happen. Who are they trying to warn us about controlling, about categorizing us, about society now, right? This is something that's for kids going through high school, right? The types of things that you would hear. I came across this in a research book that I was reading called Growing Young. It was one that was doing a whole bunch of kind of cool studies, and the researcher said this is a defining experience for this generation of teenagers is systematic abandonment. In his ethnographic research, Chuck Clark commonly encountered teenagers who viewed neighbors, relatives, teachers, coaches, pastors, priests, and parents as too busy or too self-absorbed to invest in them without an agenda. The family, once a hub of belonging for young people, now increases pressure and a sense of loneliness. So this is obviously not news to any of us here at all. But the point is this is getting studied, and one of the main things, hands down, that runs through young adult dystopian stuff is this idea of what a 21st century rite of passage looks like for kids today, growing up without parents. So in our three big young adult novels, from the Hunger Games series to Divergent to Maze Runner, in all three of those, there is literally no parental involvement with the heroes. Literally none. There's like a sliver of it in the Hunger Games series, but that's about it. The fallibility and unreliability of parents. So in Maze Runner, it literally takes a movie and a half before you find one adult that's not evil. One and a half movies before you find one adult that's not evil. There's not a single lead adult in the series at all, like a lead role in the films. In the Divergent movies, there's not a single lead role by an adult. You know, you might have one or two secondary roles, but there's not a single lead role of an adult that is helping young people through their rites of passage or overthrowing government or whatever it is. Parents or our parents' ideologies are the problem.
Doesn't it also show that at times when societies have challenges that their parents, be they political parents might be afraid to face them or deal with them because they are thinking of the consequences that they do, they are thinking of the future.
Yes, yeah, right? There's no question about that.
And they look at the futures being what belongs to them, not or whatever problems are
Yes, yeah, and so that's a big thing here, right? Especially in the third one here, right? Our parents have created for us a future that is terrible, right? That's kind of the theme that runs through these. And of course, we're not analyzing these or assessing them right now. We're just saying that's what the main theme of these books are, and there's no question about it. This is visited over and over again in the Mockingjay series, for example. The world that our parents have given us is this world of capital. The environmental problems that we're living through today, it's the result of our parents. What in the world have we received from our parents? It's just over and over again. Yeah. Major focus on the choices of our ancestors just screwing things up for us. That's the theme, right? Objectification of materialism. Fashion, clothing, possessions is a sign of value. So this is huge if you think about it. One of the main themes of the Hunger Games is fashion, and that's in both the books and in the movie, and the power of fashion, and the power of fashion to do evil things, so to speak, or the power or using fashion for goals, right? Political goals, so to speak, and things like that, to control people. Inner versus outer beauty. There's just no question, right? So if we're looking then at traditional dystopias and young adult dystopias, and we're comparing them, so traditional dystopias, we might say they attempt realistic predictions. So the whole point of 1984, the whole point of Brave New World is the authors aren't saying, I think it's going to exactly end up this way. But they are saying that I am portraying some very real future possibilities for us. Right? Aldous Huxley was saying eugenics is a real problem that we're going to face in the future. And he was right. Right? We see that developing. The traditional dystopias are clearly trying to make predictions about how things are going to go awry. Young adult dystopias, terribly unrealistic, not really possible futures. There's no question about it. There is no way that there's going to be a giant maze the size that they are in The Maze Runner in the future. The amount of money that it costs to make those mazes, they could use it far better to find whatever cure that they need, right? The Divergent series, right? I do not think that the writers and the scriptwriters that they're seriously saying in the future we're going to categorize people according to their personalities, right? In this actual way that a government's actually going to do this. Right? I do not think that Suzanne Collins actually thinks that there's going to be Hunger Games in the future. Right? So they're not making these predictions about the future. So there's got to be a reason that they're doing it, why they're constructing these types of worlds that are different. So there was a great New Yorker article on dystopic fiction and young adult fiction. And the way that the author talked about it is he said, maybe think about it this way. Do you remember Barack Obama's platform for election the first time around was "Yes, we can," and it was, you know, very famous campaign slogan, right, that he was using. So the author was saying you can kind of think of that. The reason why it had such draw is because it connected in a very special way with millennials and young adults at the time. Traditional dystopias, the whole point is this author was saying was to say no, we can't. Right, that there's going to be things that we're going to face in the future, and when we get there, there's just no way that we're going to get around it. Or they address huge amounts of disillusionment as well. He wrote equal rights for women, emancipation, reconstruction, civil rights, so many hopes dashed. Right, so the whole point is very negative. No, we can't. Young adult dystopia, it's the exact opposite. They're saying, yes, we can make changes, we can overthrow the systems, quote unquote. We gotta talk about what those systems are. They're not unrealistic in that we can set up a utopia afterwards, but they are saying we can make changes. Traditional dystopias, again, it's a possible future. Young adult dystopias, the whole point is that they're creating an allegory for the present. They are exploring real themes that young adults are struggling with today, and the way that they're doing it is by creating this world where those themes take on concrete form.
right? In the exact same way that like superhero fiction, right, might take something like the Hulk's, take anger problems, right, and turn it into a person, the Hulk, right? Divergent literally takes things like being categorized by your personality and turns it into a physical governance system for you to physically have to stare down and physically overthrow. They're allegories of things that we are dealing with today. Traditional dystopia is a possible dystopian future. Then the whole point of young adult dystopia is that the dystopian future is now. Right? We are living currently right now in a time when we have these real elements that we're struggling with. Traditional dystopia, humans can and will do terrible things for power. Young adult dystopia, humans can and are doing terrible things for power. And maybe just one way of finally kind of closing our illustration here. Did I have? What is this? I don't even know what I have here. We got. Here we go. Here's our last thing. Human nature is violent. Often heroes like Katniss are deeply flawed, and they're part of the problem as much as the solution. So I don't know if you've read the novels, but they softened her quite a bit in the movies. Katniss is a terrible character. She's supposed to be a model for teens today. There's no question as far as what the goals are of the author, but she's terrible. She treats only downtrodden people really well. She's driven entirely by vengeance. She treats the two male characters that are good, that have crushes on her, she treats them horribly throughout all three books. She's just a monster towards them. She cares little for the resistance. She cares little for good order in any way. She has the slimmest of ethical backbones. And she leads countless friends to death over her personal vendetta. If you actually think about what's going on in that third book or that fourth movie, she is literally leading all of her friends to death because she wants to personally execute, what's his name? Snow, right? She's a problem. There's no question about it. In fact, I think this is made clear in the book too, so Stan Collins, in The Mockingjay, this is Katniss talking to herself right in her monologue, kind of voice. Swathed in silk, I feel like a caterpillar in a cocoon awaiting metamorphosis. I always supposed that to be a peaceful condition. At first it is, but as I journey into night, I feel more and more trapped, suffocated by the slippery bindings, unable to emerge until I have transformed into something of beauty. I squirm, trying to shed my ruined body and unlock the secret to growing flawless wings. Despite enormous effort, I remain a hideous creature, fired into my current form by the blast from the bombs. And she remains this hideous creature throughout the entire novel. She never heals. There's no question. One of the last lines of the book, she writes, "My children who don't know, they play on a graveyard." And so there's this theme of the idea that people are torn. You might overthrow this or that. You might be able to conquer this or that type of thing that you're facing in the real world. But the reality is that you remain broken all the way to the end, and you are simply building your new society on the bones of evil and on the bones of tragedies of the past. Dystopian powers are overthrown, but the same evil powers will inevitably rise again. So as far as I know, this is the case in just about every young adult dystopian book. They overthrow the power. So the giver doesn't quite get there because the kid just escapes. That's all that happens. We don't know what happens to him after he escapes. But in current young adult dystopian literature, they set the stage very clearly that this can all possibly happen again in the future. We've got peace for now, but that does not mean it's going to last. And then finally, humans are violent and cruel, every one of them. And so one of the shocking things about this whole genre is it is extremely violent. If you're thinking of the fact that these are books written specifically for young adults, right, for teenagers, they're being casted for 14 and 15 year olds, and they are loaded with death, loaded with violence. Even the premise of The Hunger Games is just absolutely terrifying if you think about it. So the idea of human nature being violent, right, is just something that you can't get away from. And so maybe traditional dystopias, they're extremely narcissistic. If you take a step in too far in this direction, there's no return. You have to be careful about what the future has to hold. Young adult dystopias, and for saying, yes, we can make changes now. We can fight the stereotypes, and we can fight the systems that we're dealing with now. But they're definitely saying only sort of. Like, there's a real struggle, a real issue of what we can deal with. And so, the question we need to ask ourselves then, is which is it? Which is a better accurate description of the world that we live in? Yes, we can, or no, we can't. There's something we're fighting for, or we're screwed. This is me asking you. As Christians, I'm a pastor. Many of you are Christians. How do you respond to the genre? Yes, we can, or no, we can't. You say we can.
We can, but there are challenges, so it's in the middle of the thing as well.
Okay. You are not a young adult, by the way. You are very optimistic. This is a good thing. Good. Yeah.
If you're living by a no we can't model, like, that's just really sad, though. Like, what are you even living for? You're just like, nope, it's done. Like, you're all going to die.
It's depressing.
Yeah. I think most people would say this.
Just because they want to?
Most of the people I know are pretty optimistic, even a little bit.
But are they living an illusion? Yeah, Toby?
I'll say no, we can't. Just because if they think that this is going right, and I don't know, I don't think anything could really could change, because it's like just all going downhill. I don't have like a reason, but just by looking at what's going on around the world, it seems like it's like going some kind of return.
Yeah. So despite the fact that we mentioned in the beginning that young adults, clearly, if we're looking historically, in North America anyways, way better off than any other time in history, right? Yet, the future, like we're actually considering the future, there's some scary things, right, that would tell us we've got major global problems that we're facing. Yeah, in the back.
I'd say no, we can't, because if you look at the 1800s and now, considering we have new technology and advancements, and then 1800s, let's say, like, I don't know, the can was the greatest technology that they had back then. Have we really changed that much? Has it really gotten better or gotten worse? Would you say it really gotten worse? Because with all these abandonments, there's comes with new problems with the can. They always had problems. Is now that, well, now anyone can own this thing and blow whatever they want up. Now it's the same thing with nuclear weapons. Whoever owns this thing, blow anything up.
Yeah, very, very astute, right? So, Ismael, what was that Brazilian philosopher documentary I watched? Yeah, right? So, this guy. He had this very interesting comment that he made, where he said, we can talk about the idea of our knowledge of politics increasing over time, that we're getting better at understanding politics, but that doesn't in any way, shape, or form translate into actually doing politics better, right? So you can learn more about ethics, but that doesn't necessarily make you more ethical, right? That's like learning more about football doesn't make me, actually better at playing football, right?
Yes, it does, because like a couple hundred years ago, like
So we can talk about the development of certain practices, right? Yeah, right, taking place in different areas. But I think we'd all agree, like, human nature itself has remained the same. So despite the fact that we've made advancements in different ways, one of the main themes that's being explored here in young adult stuff is that human nature remains, that you can't actually change that. You can change your situations, you can change how people treat each other on a very kind of outward way, but you can't actually change who a person is. You can't change a human's potential for evil. That remains. And so, this is kind of interesting. This is from the Bible. This is from a guy named Solomon. He wrote a book called Ecclesiastes, and look at the way that he describes the world. Because again, I looked and saw all the oppression that was taking place under the sun. I saw the tears of the oppressed, and they have no comforter. Power was on the side of their oppressors, and they have no comforter. And I declared that the dead, who had already died, are happier than the living, who are still alive. But better than both is he who has not yet been, who has not seen the evil that is done under the sun. And I saw that all labor and all achievements spring from man's envy of his neighbor. This too is meaningless. Chasing after the wind. Right, and so what's Solomon's point here? His point is, under the sun, as we see the world kind of in its brute facts, if you're just kind of looking at things as they appear to you, this is a horrible place. Right? We can make that conclusion that there is injustice, that people get away with wrong stuff all the time. And just because we might be able to catch this criminal doesn't in any way actually say that you can do it. In fact, there was a study that was done, about 15 years ago on whether or not crime pays, and it turns out it does. the study was saying, it was like a big major one, that more people get away with, you know, certain crimes that they were researching than not. The whole point being is that if we're kind of considering the world as it is in its brute facts, Solomon is coming to a very similar conclusion. To what some of our young adult novelists and traditional dystopian novelists would say as well. That there's an awful lot of injustice, an awful lot of oppression. Power is not necessarily on the side of good as you kind of experience things here. And so Solomon's solution then is you have to consider this world over the sun. You have to see things from a different point of view. If you're just kind of considering things as they appear to you, in this kind of empirical form before you, then things are going to be rather dismal. But his conclusion at the very end of the book is he's got one small little phrase that makes all the difference in the world. He says, remember your creator. And so what he's doing is he's casting your eyes higher so that you can see the full account of what's going on, that you can see the full view of things. And from that, maybe under the sun, if you're just looking at this world and its brute facts, then it's pretty hard to come to another conclusion other than no, you can't. But if you begin to see things from a different viewpoint, from a higher viewpoint, then all of a sudden things change. Then all of a sudden there's a new type of hope. And what's interesting is if we consider all of the different types of young adult that's put out there, they all share this message that good can triumph, right? And Christians would say good can triumph too. Why? It's because good has already triumphed. And so all these end up being extremely powerful gospel metaphors if you think about it. Young adult novels are full of these gospel analogies, we might call them. Stories of self-sacrifice to save a dying world, right, to heal a sick world, all through the giving of one's life, right, is the major theme that kind of runs through them. There are many reminders of this kind of Solomon greater narrative that he wants us to read. This world is dystopian at times for us, like Solomon says, but we need a savior in order to find some other way out of it. And so maybe this would be a good way of kind of ending it. The Christian hope doesn't come from the strength of people in the same way that young adult novels are going to try to look for the strength within us. There's no question, you walk away from a movie like The Giver, and you feel life is wonderful, right? The diversity of life is wonderful. But the strength to change, it has to come from somewhere else other than the individual, if the individual is the person that is corrupt, right? And so the whole point of Christianity is to say that change is possible, right? But things are being made new by a person other than us, right? Who says these words at the end, the very last book of the Bible? It's a vision of the future. Who says these words? Yeah, Jesus says these words. So this is John seeing a vision, and in that vision, Jesus says the words, "I'm making everything new." We do have hope, and that hope comes from somewhere. It comes from someone, that the Creator is making everything new. But you have to be able to cast your vision higher. Otherwise, this is we can't hope. It's very hard to get around that. But cast your eyes a little bit higher. Look for a savior from someone else other than yourself. And all of a sudden, we might be able to say, yes, we can. So that's my take on dystopian literature. Any questions at this point? Thoughts about anything you mentioned? Yeah.
Doesn't there need to be a balance? Doesn't there need to be like a balance between good and evil?
How so?
I don't know, I feel like if evil per se didn't exist, good couldn't either, because then you couldn't define something as good. No, if that makes sense.
Yeah, right? So you're saying that in order for there to be good, there needs to be evil. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Yeah, so what's interesting is, so for example, C.S. Lewis made this argument, why would God allow there to be pain and human suffering in this world? And C.S. Lewis's response to that is, in order for someone to truly choose to love you. So for example, a future spouse, do you want that person to be programmed to love you, or do you want them to choose to love you? Which would you rather have? Choose, right? The vast majority of people, except for Nick, have that you can choose that, right? But in order for a future spouse to have the potential to choose you, what else do they need to have the potential to not choose to love you. So from a logical point of view, C.S. Lewis would argue, if you want creatures that can truly choose to love, then you're going to have the very real potential for them to choose to hate. Now that's a philosophical argument. You can't find that anywhere in the pages of scripture. That's just a way of trying to understand how in the world we got the place that we do have. But we can say this, unequivocally, the God of the Bible is a God of love. He is a God that loves. He is a God that, as three persons, the way that we understand the Trinity according to Scripture, it's three persons that are in this loving fellowship with each other. And the picture of Scripture is that this love, this eternal love, this great godly holy love spilled out into the desire to create other creatures that could love. That's the world that we have. Now, things went wrong. There's no question about that. But the goal, the biblical goal, was not that this would be a dystopian world in the young adult sense. But it's a process of being renewed and a process of being overcome through Christ. So, good question. Other thoughts? Thank you.
So yeah, first of all, yeah, the big thanks to Pastor Thompson for his office. Put a lot of work into that. And again, thanks to everyone for coming too. So this is Barbara Illuminate, and although we're only on campus one semester, we went out and went to Carleton. We actually have events every Friday night as well. So we have our debut series every night. Right now we're talking about... we're talking about First Peter, we're talking about counterculture, and so why do we feel so different in society. And we also have a bunch of other events too. We have film and theology nights to talk about films and girls lost to hear a lot about that. We have games nights, we have homie dinners every week as well. So we have some information up front here. We have some free water bottles for you as well. If anyone wants one of those, go ahead and take one. If anyone wants to get any more information, we have email sign up sheet here too. We have some pamphlets. So next Friday, we're actually hosting one of our regular socials. We're doing our countercultural thing. And we're actually having people from Pretzels, yeah. We're actually having one of the head chefs, I believe, from Bridgehead. And he's going to come teach us how to make